The Jacob Media Sports Network, in partnership with 97.3 ESPN, brings you the Mays and Eytan Show.
Middays with Harry Mays and Eytan Shander.
Now, it's the Midday Show with Harry Mays and Eytan Shander on 97.3 ESPN Radio.
Well, we finally get back to work for the Philadelphia Eagles. Is this thing on? We also return, as far as the Philadelphia 76ers did yesterday, ahead of us, home. But it doesn't matter, home or away, it's still the same old story, at least this early into the regular season. And a regrettable weekend for Josh, to say the least, for our college picks. But it was an off week, not only just for picking, but just in general.
Somebody had an off week. I went 8-1.
Yeah, well,
that's all I know.
The whole idea of the segment is if you're in, then you lock in.
Yeah,
otherwise,
well, I chose better. I looked at the picks again on Saturday morning, and outside of I think San Jose State, which I liked anyway myself, I went with Tennessee, which ended up being the correct side, and I went with five or six other picks that were all my own.
Okay, well, the point of the segment is that if you're on Josh's side in the segment, then you lock in then.
Yeah.
Otherwise, it's, you know, everybody's going to have the benefit of that moving forward. So
what
that's
do you mean the benefit of that?
Well, of being able to not lock in on that segment and either Saturday morning or Monday morning or wherever be like, well, you know, I bounced out of it. Like, if you're in with Josh.
No, I'm not in. Right. I'm in with myself. I picked my own goddamn
but
game.
You said you were in with Josh.
Well, I lied.
All right. Because
the picks sucked.
All right.
Okay.
Well, they did clearly suck.
Yeah.
So you keep your own picks.
Yes.
All right. And Josh and I will do that segment on our own.
Good.
You could walk around the sports book.
Awesome.
And get a beer.
I'll
get
go grab IPA. A beer and eat a chicken
right.
ring. What do you think about that?
We don't have to hear about hindsight being 2020 here.
No, it's not hindsight, cuz.
Yeah. Are you all in, cuz?
No, I'm not all in. I am definitely. I'm as far away from all in as you can get. Okay. Does that answer any of your questions?
Yeah. Okay.
I had a great weekend. This was a phenomenal weekend. The weekend before, I had no power. I mean, the weekend absolutely sucked. It was bad in college football 2 weekends ago. This weekend was a great college weekend. You had no agita with the Eagles on Sunday, so it was a nice Sunday to just sort of relax. I went out with the wife and caddied her around, played 9 holes of golf in a beautiful day, and didn't have to watch
Did
that,
you play?
That dreck that was the 1 o'clock window in professional football. Came home
Wait
and watched the Packers and the Panthers and
the
Cowboys
1 o'clock
and
games were fine.
Ah, it sucked.
You didn't even
Jets,
watch them.
Giants.
You didn't even watch them.
Well,
though.
That's right. I don't want to watch them. No. They were donkey games.
Red Zone had me entertained beyond that. There were plenty of 1 o'clock games that were going on. I was sitting there watching the 3 o'clock hour.
Yeah,
was
how about how was that Ravens Bengals game? That was a barn burner.
Well, yeah. Well, first off, you're talking about one game, which the Ravens-Bengals game was over from the jump, and I don't know who would come to the table and want us watch that game. The other game, and you have to understand that this is a huge part of it, but that Jets-Giants game, and that wasn't the game I was even watching, but that game paid off in dividends from any type of fantasy standpoint.
Oh, okay.
Between Daniel Jones and Sam Darnold, once again. So beyond that, though, I think you saw, look, the Chiefs-Titans game was a really good game. And that came down to the wire.
Yeah, but I don't even know if I'd watch the Titans if they were in the Super Bowl.
Amen.
Seriously.
Look, that's something where you are in the extreme minority, and there's nothing that like anybody can do.
But I probably would do that. I probably would skip the Super Bowl if they were ever in it again. I know they were in it years ago against the Rams, and it came down to the final play. I probably wouldn't watch the Titans do anything.
Well,
that's how irrelevant they are to me.
To you, okay. Yeah. To the rest of the NFL, they beat the Chiefs.
Okay, good.
Patrick Mahomes came back. Well, I think that's actually a pretty big victory. We saw the Saints.
What happened to them?
That was the worst. That's what I'm saying. That was the worst loss of the season by anybody to date.
That's
was
horrendous.
The New Orleans Saints. Now, they put up 3 field goals throughout the game.
Yeah, that's worse than the Eagles' loss to the Falcons in
Week 2.
Oh,
by far.
I mean, seriously.
By far.
They just didn't show up, I guess.
No, I'm telling you, I was watching a lot of that game, and every single time Drew Brees dropped back, he was under pressure, which is crazy because the Falcons are one of the worst teams in the NFL when it comes to pressuring the quarterback. So it really didn't make any sense. And on top of that, they weren't even throwing deep. Like, you figure they were down at one point. They were down by, you know, 9 points. They weren't able to do anything. They weren't even throwing deep.
Wow.
Saints, look, the Saints took a loss that I don't think Patriots or Niners or the Ravens, these teams wouldn't take. Like, that was pretty eye-opening. To see the Saints lose like that.
Yeah, that would almost be like the Patriots losing to, like, the Dolphins
Cleveland,
or the Jets
right,
or something.
Right.
You know what I mean? Within their division and a team that's really underperforming.
Correct.
So, yeah, that was a shocker. I mean, I guess it was good. It was good for the Eagles that the Rams lost yesterday. In case you're still thinking about possible wild card scenarios, that's something that came to mind. Of course, Dallas losing is great.
Yes, but here's the thing. I almost think that short term, the Eagles were better off if the Vikings lost last night as opposed to the Cowboys winning. Meaning, I honestly think, look, the Seahawks have that wild card spot locked up. I don't think anybody's going to catch Seattle for that first wild card.
Probably not.
Which now leaves two wild card slots left. So if, in fact, the Eagles were technically a game and a half behind the Cowboys, there's still so much time for Dallas to lose football games.
And they've got tough games.
Absolutely. That's my point.
Collinsworth was trying to make the case that the Eagles' schedule down the line in its entirety is tougher than the Cowboys. I don't know what he's looking at. But anyway, he said that last night along with a couple of other things.
The Dak Prescott thing was probably the worst of it all.
How did he get that wrong?
Well, we need to play this audio here.
I mean, that was embarrassing.
Yeah, it was. I don't know how you come out and say that and then in your apology say that you mangled it or jumbled it. Right?
He tried to walk it back and it kind of made it almost worse, didn't it?
No, it did. All right. I'm going to, of course, back after this is the one who has it.
Well, of course. They've got everything.
So I'm going to send this over here to Josh now
and
see if, in fact, we can get this up at some point because it was one of the most unfortunate things. But here's the thing. My point in Dallas is this. If they had lost, if the Cowboys had won last night, the division is still clearly attainable because the Eagles have their schedule, which is lighter, the Cowboys' schedule, which is heavier. The Vikings, on the other hand, by winning, are getting closer to locking up that second wild card spot.
Yeah, but I mean, they've also got head-to-head against the Eagles, too, so even if they end in a tie. So I don't know. I'm not even really thinking so much about it. I'm thinking about division only, really. I really am.
Yeah, but if it's a loss yesterday, then with the other two teams you mentioned, all of a sudden both open up. That's my point, is that it's crazy to think about this long term, but short term, if in fact, if you look at this, right, if in fact you have both teams, the Eagles who are right behind the Cowboys, but now it's not just the division, it's a wild card spot because the Rams, the Panthers, now in this case the Vikings, lose. That's what I'm saying. If they all lose, then that second wild card spot, just like the division, starts to open up. If you beat the Patriots.
Right. Well, yeah.
Right.
And I actually, for some reason, like their chances against the Patriots more than I do Seattle in these next two
just,
weeks.
Is it a matchup thing? Or?
Yeah, kind of. It's just like, I mean, Seattle's really good on the road this year. They're undefeated on the road. They've actually lost their games at home. And Russell Wilson is such a wild card when it comes to, you know, I look at this Eagles linebacking crew and they are just, you know, average to below average at best,
right?
And I just think, you know, having to sort of spy him is a real chore. He can change plays just simply with, you know, a couple of strides with his legs can get him into a spot where he can free himself up to get the ball deep down the field. I mean, he just can do so many different things. Brady's, you know where Brady's going to be. He's going to be in the pocket.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
But even still, I mean, he's where he is.
I get
and
that.
He shifts. And
yeah,
moves
he's a slider. He's a tremendous slider within the pocket. But I'm just saying, I just think Russell
Wilson.
What
about that defense, though? I mean, here's the thing.
That defense was exposed a little bit a week or so.
Well, yeah, against Lamar Jackson.
Well, I'm just saying.
I mean, Lamar Jackson just torched Cincinnati single-handedly. I think the difference for me, though, is that
Cincinnati Bearcats could sort
probably
Cincinnati this year, I think.
But Lamar Jackson aside, the Patriots defense does something that the Seahawks defense doesn't do this year, and that's pressure the quarterback.
Mm-hmm.
So you're right. Seattle is a better team on the road. Russell Wilson is the MVP this year, outside of maybe Lamar Jackson.
Or Christian McCaffrey, but now they've lost again. But, yeah,
I mean, Rodgers
Dalvin
might be
Cook
back up
there. Has got to be in that conversation, too, man. How about the game he had yesterday, last night?
I wonder if he is, as they keep winning football games, because McCaffrey might open up the door.
Yeah. How about Kyle Rudolph last night? You see, how about the catch he made in the back of the end zone?
See, I'm telling you,
jeez,
man. I added a little spice to that game by doing a DFS thing.
Oh, yeah? So who was your captain?
Kyle Rudolph.
Yeah?
I did two teams. One was Kyle Rudolph. The other was Amari Cooper.
Okay.
So I do one and the other right there. And, you know, listen, it's small money, but it pays off.
Like, how does Dallas not go? Speaking of Amari Cooper, how did they not look Amari Cooper's way in those final couple
of
plays?
At all. They were running the ball more than looking at Cooper at the end.
Yeah, didn't they run it twice, and then they threw like an option route to Ezekiel Elliott, and Kendricks made an unbelievable play on the ball. But still, I'm like, man, it was a good throw. But, Amari Cooper was great last night.
I know. And
I thought Dak was really good last night.
They both were. Both offenses played really well. And even Diggs, who kind of disappeared, you saw, like, without Thielen and Diggs, who was held in check, they were still able, and Cook was a big part of it, but they were still able to move the football. And you saw a couple of big runs from Cook, even when they were up late in the second half. And it's nice to see that, but still, even as good of a game, great of a game as Dalvin Cook had, Kirk Cousins still had to make a throw or two.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it wasn't just handed to him by any means.
No, the one thing, Minnesota came in there with the idea, the objective, we're not going to let Ezekiel Elliott run on us. And they did it.
Yep.
You know what I mean? And Dak was really good. And, you know, maybe some crazy play calling down the stretch. Who knows? But that was a really, really good game. That felt like kind of a playoff game, didn't it?
Well, yeah, and I think you saw two teams that were headed toward the playoffs, right? I mean, right now Dallas still in the lead, depending on what happens with the Eagles and moving forward. But two teams, one in a playoff position in Minnesota that at least is in that second wild card spot, and the other being the Cowboys, which is ahead of their division. So, yeah, I agree. It definitely had that atmosphere, like two teams vying for playoff spots, you know, like close to the end of the year, or maybe like that first wild card round where Dallas wins their division. They host a wild card.
Right, they host the wild card Minnesota, yeah. And tonight will be the same thing.
Well,
I
think
can't wait for tonight.
Tonight, I think, is going to feel even more like, tonight's going to feel like the NFC Championship game. It's been built up like this.
Oh, yeah?
All week. I'm telling you, this is going to be, we had the upset of the year so far in the Atlanta Falcons game. Matt Ryan decides to make some throws, and he wasn't even over 200 yards, but that defense all of a sudden decided to pressure Drew Brees, and now we're going to have the game of the year.
Mm.
We won't have a better game, mark it. We won't have it to date. What's the game of the year so far?
As far as that has been played?
Yep. Now, it's an open it. Josh, do you have any idea you want to add into this?
As far as game of the year in the NFL thus far. Well, the Chiefs have lost a bunch of games. I'm trying to think, like, who is New England? New England really hasn't played anybody. New England, Baltimore, maybe. Would that have been the game of the year? I mean, I know it didn't end up close on the scoreboard.
New England, Baltimore was close for about a half.
Yeah.
And then they started to pull away a little bit. Here's the thing. That was hyped up. I'll give you this. That was hyped up as
like a precursor to an AFC championship type of game, right?
Right.
But the Chiefs have fallen off.
It didn't live up to it yet, though.
No.
See, that's what I'm saying.
So you're saying a game that has played that has lived up to the billing in the NFL.
Yep. So I think tonight
be the NFL. I hope it lives up to it. Last night was pretty good.
Yes.
Yeah, Eagles, Packers, a little early in the year, but the Eagles fall behind by 10 and come back on the road and beat Aaron Rodgers. It's got to be a candidate, right? It's got to be in the mix.
I think that's up there. I just tweeted it out. Get a retweet here by the station, maybe you as well.
I mean, because if you look at some of these other divisions, like the AFC West, the Chargers are down this year, right?
Well,
Denver's no good. You got to have, like, you know, two really good teams facing off and then both of them playing well and living up to it. Baltimore, New England would have to be in there, even though the score wasn't all that close.
Are we missing another Ravens game? Are we missing a game where the Ravens beat somebody else?
I'm going to look here at the Ravens schedule.
So I think tonight will be the NFL game of the year to date. Which game has been the best one so far this season?
Ravens Steelers at Pittsburgh. Of course, no Ben was 26-23 Ravens on the road.
That's not bad.
That's not bad.
No Ben in that one.
Right.
Now, Mason Rudolph and company weren't terrible by any means.
The Chiefs beat the Ravens in Kansas City. Yeah, that was 33-28. That was week three, and Mahomes played in that game.
He did. That's a good game.
Yeah,
so far.
That might be the game.
Patrick Mullen at Pat Mullen, Texans and Saints week one. They have to go back to the start of the season. But that game
was good.
Right, that opened up everything.
And the Ravens play the Texans this week.
They do play the
Texans. That's one of the better games on this guy. Yeah, 30-28 at New Orleans. Saints win. I do. That was that a Monday night game?
Ooh, you'd have to check, but I think that. I mean, Deshaun Watson. I think played his ass off, right?
Yeah. Well, he had three touchdowns and a pick, 268.
I think he
made
ran
some incredible plays.
Yeah. I mean, it was.
I remember watching
fireworks. It wasn't a Thursday night game.
Lutz had to hit a 58 yarder to
win the
game.
That's right.
Remember that?
I remember that. Wait. It wasn't a Thursday night game, right? I do remember the field goal.
It was a Monday night game.
Monday night game.
That's a good one.
Yeah, that is a great one. That ended the first week of the season with a bang. It's not often that you get something on a Monday night that supersedes everything else.
Right.
And I think that's probably part of it tonight is that we had a great one. I don't know. Rederson, Jets versus Giants, so evenly matched.
Well, one of the night games of week one was that New England-Pittsburgh game, which was just a
well, that's the one that
runaway.
Knocked Big Ben out.
Roethlisberger was out, and Pittsburgh got blown out.
Right,
but
absolutely.
You had expectations for that game, and it didn't deliver.
Yeah, and the other one that you brought up, which was the Ravens and Patriots, that one had a ton of expectations. Mm-hmm. I don't think we'll be disappointed tonight. I think tonight we're going to get good football. Now, are you concerned at all about Joel Embiid's conditioning? Because I was asked that this morning by Mike Jerick and Alex Holly. I'm sure you've seen multiple tweets on social. Once again, as Embiid at home this time, you know, turn the ball over a couple of times at the end of the game, and people want to vilify him for not looking in shape. Are we at a point right now where nine games into the season,
and we're already considering this? Well, if that's the case,
well,
if he indeed is not in good physical condition, that is alarming to me.
But is he? Brett Brown swears he's not. See, that's the thing. It's not like the team has admitted this. They're saying, no, there's no issue here.
It kind of goes with what we were saying last week. When you're watching him, he just... No matter how, if he's in good shape or not, he's always going to be kind of this lumbering, gigantic man.
Yep.
You know what I mean? That when he's doing these gifted athletic things that, you know, guys half his size can't even do.
Right.
Okay. Sometimes it doesn't look all that pretty.
Right.
But it gets done. Like, he gets it done. But yet you might think, well, man, if he was in better shape, he'd probably be able to, you know, do that more smoothly. I don't know that that's the case.
No, I know it's not the case. I'm with you.
Do you know what I'm saying?
Yes.
Like, I think that kind of works against him.
Right. I think you're right. It does work against him, and it's not something that will immediately fix whatever people think that the problem is.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a magic pill that's going to overnightly fix this, right?
Right.
I don't know.
How about cork moss?
Well, here we go.
I'll tell you.
Here we go.
Growing a bomber.
Nine games into it, and they're fitting him for a statue.
It is happening.
They are hitting him for a statue. Well, here's the thing.
You got to start wearing a bomber jacket and like Ray-Bans. Just like Tom Cruise in Top Gun. That's what he ought to do. I need a meme from some of our really talented listeners that are good at this stuff on the internet. A cork moss in a bomber jacket, Ray-Ban sunglasses, slicked back Turkish hair. I need the whole deal.
Oh, my God.
You just Photoshop Kelly McGillis into the damn thing, too, while you're at it.
Photoshop me out of the show.
Well, you're out. Yeah, you're out.
I couldn't be more. I'm all out.
Yes,
I
need a little Kenny Loggins. Please.
I am all out, man.
When I look at Furkan Korkmaz from now on, I'm going to hear Kenny Loggins.
I can't believe this is Kenny Loggins.
I don't know that this is. This is just sort of background.
I thought you were telling me that this
is
Kenny Loggins.
No, but he did the
Danger
feature
Zone
song.
Yeah, Highway to the Danger Zone. Yeah. See, isn't it funny, though, that, like, think about the discrepancy or the gap, if you will, between the Danger Zone song, and then didn't he also do...
He did a ton of sound.
He did something on Caddyshack.
I'm All Right.
Right.
Yeah. Right. Now, here's the Danger Zone.
That's what I'm saying. So, like, those are two...
He did Footloose, too.
He did Footloose. Yeah. Well, those are two completely different songs, though.
He did one on Footloose. I think he did the feature song on Footloose, didn't he? That time in the 80s, he was in every movie, man.
Is this right? Did he do all three?
I think he did.
Boy, I tell you, I didn't realize that he dominated the scene.
God, was a monster.
Well, I knew that he did Caddyshack and this crap, right?
This song's great.
Well, it's associated with an awful movie.
You didn't like that movie?
We need to put it past this.
Listen, in the mid-80s, that was top flight.
I need to move. Okay. This isn't some live show in which, you know, the first time you got to see Zeppelin tour their third album and we should hold it close to our heart.
Uh-huh.
This is Top Gun. I think we've had better movies since.
Well, aside from the baby oiled volleyball scene, I thought that was a really great movie for the time period that it was in.
No, see, I disagree. I think that we continue to settle for certain crap out of nostalgia. Not everything. But there are certain things that I think we hold on to out of nostalgia. And Top Gun.
Of course.
The idea that Top Gun, you wouldn't sit through 20 minutes of Top Gun.
Yeah, I would. That's a click and stick, as our old buddy used to say.
Oh, man.
Okay? Stick and click. Right.
No, I disagree.
Yeah, it is. Come on.
You would not be
Those fight scenes in the Jets?
You'd be excited for about 5 minutes, and then you'd look and think, this movie is awful. The dialogue is terrible.
Him riding that Kawasaki Ninja around.
The music, Dude. The montage, everything about it is cheesier than the
of
Rocky
course
movies.
It's cheesy. The 80s were cheesy.
I know, and that's
my decade.
Look, you have it in some memory cell in your head that this thing was great.
No, I've forgotten most of the 80s. Trust me.
What? Well,
1985, they say, was a very good year for me, although I don't remember anything.
Okay, well, you go back and you start watching Top Gun, you're going to want to forget that.
Okay.
I promise you. Nobody.
All right, well, let's have people weigh in on the text.
609-403-0973. Look, it's not that it's not that I'm coming down on Harry or you out there judging.
And Loggins did do Footloose,
He did do
way.
Footloose, yes. Okay. What I'm saying is that Top Gun itself is overrated as a cult classic.
Yeah,
movie.
It's overrated. I'll give you that.
And the people like yourself who hold this thing in such high esteem wouldn't make it 10 minutes past the start of that movie.
See, now I hold Caddyshack in high esteem. I don't hold Top Gun. Look,
Caddyshack is legendary.
Caddyshack is above Top Gun.
Yeah.
Let's just be clear.
Now, being accused of trashing Top Gun by at Eagles Matt Foley on Veterans Day of all days. Well, here's the thing. I don't associate my appreciation and love for what veterans have done and continue to do for this country with Top Gun. Tom Cruise is not anywhere close to what I would associate with honoring this country.
What about Val Kilmer?
Val Kilmer is closer to what I would assume is honoring this country than Tom Cruise. Val Kilmer's got to go. These guys, that's another thing, too. Val Kilmer being a top three actor, actress in that movie is another reason why that thing is a bloated piece of hot air.
He had a couple good flicks.
Val Kilmer is a violation, as our old friend used to say. Both of our old friends used to say.
Yeah, okay. He was known as the king of movie soundtracks, was Loggins.
What's, okay.
It began with I'm All Right from Caddyshack.
There you go.
Followed by Footloose.
Caddyshack put him on the map.
Correct.
And then Footloose. Okay, Footloose was huge.
And then he had Over the Top, Danger Zone, and Playing with the Boys from Top Gun.
Wait a second, Over the Top?
Yeah, I don't remember that song.
Hold on a second. I think, that's not from the movie Over the Top, is it? Hold on a second.
Meet Me Halfway from Over the Top. Yes.
Oh, my. All right, Josh.
I don't remember that song,
though. Josh, we have to come back with Meet Me Halfway, Kenny Loggins from Over the Top. That's probably the most I was going to ask you, what's the most obscure movie he's ever done a soundtrack for?
Over the top, that's Stallone,
yes,
right?
Yes, it's okay. Stallone and Bull, who's the other arm wrestler.
Robert Loggia was in that.
Yeah, Robert Loggia.
I love Robert Loggia.